Urban Today, brought to you by
Metropolitan International University. We offer postgraduate diplomas, bachelor's degree, diploma, certificate programs, weekend, day and evening. Registrations in progress at our campuses.
Well, good morning and welcome back to the show, to this segment where we discuss foreign news. And with me in the studio right now is Daron Bartlett, and is here to discuss everything that is going on outside countries. Daron, what was your feeling the first time you got on a plane?
I was scared because of how it takes off, okay, and then also how it lands. You know, when it lands, mm-hmm, some pilots have a hard landing where you feel the tires are kind of bouncing. You feel your life is crashing. Mm-hmm. But when it's taking off, some people have some nauseas, they can vomit and things, okay, like that. I just had fear because I thought, oh, fear. What if it stops here and then we go down?
And did your family members remain to, you know, how excited were they? Were they that their son was getting on a plane?
No, what I did, no one knew.
I
was on a mission alone. Oh. But I left a provisional will by text. By text, in case
anything happens when you are in the air.
In case I have taken a plane.
Okay. At least you've been on a plane, so you've gone abroad before. So tell us what's going on in Tanzania.
Tanzania misses me. It's a country that the world is not so certain about when it comes to the COVID numbers, mm-hmm, the COVID-19 pandemic there. You remember they announced in the beginning, up to around 5,000 numbers, they, mm-hmm, went mute. Mm-hmm. The government came out and made orders and said there is no more announcing of COVID. The COVID status was not, mm-hmm, going to be given anymore. Whoever wanted to publish such information should go through the government. Mm-hmm. So it kept people in the dark, and we stopped at 5,000 and something. That's why we stopped. Till today, not even the World Health Organization knows the exact numbers that are happening in Tanzania. We well know that President Magufuli came out and told people, hey, look, we are not going to lock down. Mm. What we're going to do is, guys, just go out and associate. But in case you have a problem, you just go to the hospital. We have medicine and everything. So which Tanzania actually has a kind of a good medical system, mm-hmm, you would want to say. But what amazed me yesterday is the Minister of Health, Social Development and Gender, and the Elderly came out, that is Dr. Dorothy, came out and said, look, it looks like they're starting to accept that COVID is actually real, mm, but accepting in denial, that's what I would want to say. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So what they're doing is, she came out and told people, like, look, guys, you need to wash your hands all the time. You need to social distance. Mm-hmm. You need to get treatment in case you realize that you have some of these symptoms and signs. But what amazed me is how they crowned the ceremony. Mm. After her press conference, is they took herbs. There's a local herb. What you see there being mixed there, those were local herbs that they had made, and they drank them in front of the press, and praised themselves of how that can also help them sustain their immunity. I mean, boost their immunity.
But don't you see this Dr. Dorothy Gwajima? Don't you think she's in a collision course with Magufuli, who does not believe that there is even COVID-19?
Actually, Magufuli knows that there is COVID. Mm. What he does not believe in is the intensity of how the world reacted.
Oh, he does not want to spend money. He's trying to save on the money.
His method of treatment is likely the same as Sweden. You know, Sweden, they never locked down its country. Mm. This was the same thing that Tanzania did. They didn't lock down the country. Mm. They actually let business go on as normal. Mm. But what they were trying to do is keep distance, keep distancing. But in to the contrary of Tanzania didn't social distance and things like that.
They left everything.
Till today, things are going on as normal.
Yeah, but also we've seen the Catholic Church like come out and talk to the people and say this thing is actually going on in the country, and you know, you need to social distance, and blaming, you know, all this, keeping everything open, blaming it on increasing, you know, COVID-19. Has Magufuli said anything about that?
The same Magufuli went to church and said we need to pray to God. all you need is praying to God about this kind of, pray to God about COVID. He actually several times appeared in church talking about it. But the funny thing is how the disease is actually cropping up in there. Magufuli's son actually cured from COVID.
Oh, he got COVID and then he cured from it.
Okay. Yes. What has also happened in Zanzibar, which is still under Tanzania, their first vice president, Hassan, got COVID, and their wife. So those are a few things they could talk in the media. but in the background, it's actually bad.
Mm.
It's just that the way they are responding. Some scientists would say, oh, let's deal with a treatment called herd immunity, where you allow the disease go to people, and then
they get sick and somehow immunity
it just heals, and then their immunity now is developed to resist.
But I wonder, what is Magufuli's end point in this? Why has he refused to accept this COVID-19? What does he hope to achieve by doing this? I was also surprised he actually went ahead and won an election after, you know, after the way he's been handling the COVID. What is his end point?
Technically, any other person, just like some Kenyans are arguing and some Ugandans, saying, what is that death rate versus the people falling sick?
Okay.
When you look at the statistics, you now believe that it's about the survival chances are 99.something%.
Yes.
Because very few people have died. So people will say, but people are healing. People are healing. You get the point? Eh? Mm. So if out of 100 people, one dies, and 99%, I mean 99 people survive, it means this thing is a small thing.
Yeah, okay.
So the numbers have played parts in believing that this thing is curable. So let's move on. It's not as dangerous as Ebola, as cholera, or maybe other pandemics that we've had in East Africa before. So
yeah, and we've also seen Magufuli warning officials not to take the vaccine because they say it could be harmful harmful to the people, which is something that is questionable. But anyway, let's move on to the Central African Republic, where there is civil unrest.
Well, civil unrest in Central African Republic has been there for a very long time. It's one of those countries that have never settled. And that is why when the Pope came here in 2015, his next destination was Central African Republic, where he tried to preach peace and unity, trying to bring back the country together and try to believe in reconciliation and all those things.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, it's not happening that fast. So what happened is last year, the president, who's the current president, who is there now, Dr. Faustin. No, he's not Dr. though. Sorry, President Faustin. I was still thinking of Tanzania. I don't know why. President Faustin was he won an election, but not the they didn't have that. He didn't win by the majority needed, the percentage needed to retain the seat.
Okay.
But the opposition felt that this it was not fair and square.
Mm-hmm.
However, despite that kind of argument, there is supposed to be a rerun.
Definitely.
Which is happening on Valentine's Day here on 14th.
On Valentine's Day, they're doing a rerun of the election.
They will have an election.
So,
but the rerun, they don't need a percentage win.
Okay.
It is about the majority.
The numbers
it's just the numbers, the population.
So is it just the two of them winning the top, or everyone else is...
No. Only the two, the opposition and then the current government. However, the situation right now is that the rebel group, which is siding with the opposition, has taken over about 70-80% of the country. It has captured about 70-80%.
Wow.
They have surrounded Bangui, which is the capital city.
Mm.
The government that is there right now, where the president is only supported, or on the mercy of the UN forces, the Rwandan forces, and some French forces are the ones who are trying to now keep even the current government, the current army. So those are the rebels there who have taken over. Yeah, so it's a government living on mercy. That is what is available right now.
How long will you know foreign forces keep staying there? Can this country survive without foreign help?
No, they can't. Remember, Central African Republic it was colonized by the French.
Yes.
And most French colonized countries still have a pact, an agreement, with the French, whereby they still even control some of their taxes.
Wow.
So it's an interest already. Mm. So the French still have a huge interest in that. Most of the country, actually, if you look at the forces that are there keeping Rwanda, they're actually French speaking as well.
Mm-hmm.
They just adopted English recently, but French is their other official language.
Yes.
The French forces themselves, even part of the UN forces that are there, are all French speaking.
Mm.
So there's a huge interest there, and it's a collapsing country. That's what I would say.
And
so
there's been talk of a Russian French proxy war.
Even Russia itself is there.
Because they've been saying they're probably in a proxy war with the French, the Russians.
You know,
so what is going?
Sometimes it's deeper than we think. The agreements that countries sign with African countries that do not come out in light,
mm-hmm.
but they're in the background. You just never know. Maybe Central African Republic has minerals that Russia is interested in,
mm-hmm.
or Russia has this thing of, I need to secure your country just in case of anything. You're one of our fallback positions. You need to understand that those superpower countries sometimes actually build army bases in Africa. Just the same way China is planning to build an air army base somewhere. They said Mozambique. It's still rumored to be Mozambique, but yes, they confirmed that they will have an army in Africa. You can see US has its army bases almost everywhere in the world.
Yes.
You get it? So it doesn't surprise me that Russia has an interest there, because they actually right now they didn't have and their army anywhere apart from Central African Republic.
Mm.
So there are some of those arguments that are there that you may never know.
Yes.
That never come to light, but they can come in the name of peace, that we are coming to protect you, you're part of the world, you deserve good, so we are here to protect you and all those things.
And as for your last question, what do these rebel groups actually want? Are they power. They just want power.
Power.
Are they organized enough to have one block, or each one has
By the time they have 80%, that's a huge number. It's like the whole country has gone.
So does the current president even stand a chance?
He stands a chance, because the African forces, the African governments are behind him. I didn't want to use the word African forces,
but I mean, when you're talking about African governments, I mean, we've seen African governments, how they support. Sometimes they will just sit in the background.
They may speak, but they're
not going to come and help
actually,
you
recently,
out.
Dr. Faustin, I don't know why I keep calling him Dr. President Faustin, was in Angola, where they were having a meeting about the great, they were having meetings between Great Lakes countries, the region, basically. Mm. And they were discussing the stability of that country.
Mm.
But, I mean, how many countries are in the Great Lakes? About 7, 8. But which country is actually on ground trying to protect the Central African Republic?
I mean, we're seeing it's just Rwanda that has done that. But what is Angola willing? Angola is said to have the most seasoned army in Africa.
Uganda,
are they willing to go there?
No, I don't think so. No. Because they are willing by speaking.
Yeah, but they're not going to be there.
Because even Uganda, we have our army there, but it is there on a particular mission, which is the LRA.
Of course.
They're not there for any other purpose.
Just
that. So maybe we may consider supporting them and protecting them. You just never know.
Okay, let's move on to Ethiopia's Tigray crisis, where 50,000 people are thought to have died.
Well, the number is not so certain, the three opposition parties which was working with the Tigray believe that there are about 50,000 people who have died. Yes, even the UN believes that that number could even actually be higher, because any place where there is war expect casualties or
Definitely.
Victims of war.
Mm.
We know what happened last year, coming into January, when the Prime Minister ordered that they should go and bring down the Tigray.
Mm.
And all this thing escalated from a point where they wanted to have an election, but the central government said, no, we cannot have an election in the crisis we are in right now. We are dealing with a pandemic. Election is going to make things worse.
Mm-hmm.
And the Tigray did not agree to that. But you also know that the Tigray had actually the biggest majority of probably member of parliaments. They were in government and all those
things. Yes. And also, we've heard that their party was deregistered.
It was now deregistered.
Does that take the fire out of them, or they are still fighting? How has that affected the way they look at the
system? It already takes away the fire from them, but it doesn't stop them from joining the other political parties or forming something else and fight back the government. And it does not also take away the hate of the Tigray region has for the government.
Yeah, but I have a question. Why particularly Tigray? Do they want to break away and become their own community? It looks like it's like a tribal sentiment. You have an area that wants, they particularly want special rights. I mean, the country is large enough, there are other communities, but why this particular Tigray area?
Let me make an example here, and I'm going to bring it home to Uganda.
Okay.
Think about it that the NRM government took power in 1986, okay? They have been in government positions for a very long time.
Yes.
Now, if you woke up one morning and another government comes into power from the opposition,
of course,
they will have to deal with, you know, completely removing the NRM in all sectors.
Mm.
You get it? Government offices and all those things, parliament, because they're still the majority.
Mm.
So dealing with such a thing takes really time.
So
that's what happened.
Yeah,
the Tigray, when they captured power, they occupied almost, actually, they are the first. What they first did is to take over Didn't they take over, but they talked the other political parties into
joining
one party.
Them, yes.
So the Tigray became so big in the whole country. They were the majority in the cabinet. They were the majority in parliament. They were doing everything in all government positions. They were the ones.
Yes.
By the time Abiy came, he was like a guy who was picked to bring reconciliation in a country.
Yes.
Which was divided on tribal lines, political lines, and all those things. So to break down that, the Tigray, you know,
dominance.
The dominance has taken that quite time, and that is why when they wanted an election to happen, maybe the Tigray thought, no, we need to remove the prime minister from here if we are still to regain our power. He says, no, you cannot have this election because we have a pandemic, and then a disagreement starts from there. They say they decided that in their region they are going to hold an election because they have regions.
Yes,
and I could say. There was a proposal here in Uganda before to have regional tier.
Some kind of federal, regions,
yeah, the kind
a
of
glorified
the
federal system.
Yes. So then they wanted to have theirs, and it was a threat to a government.
Yes.
Already they have their own army that is there, but they were working together with the central government army to keep peace in the country.
Mm.
Now, you're dealing with the guys who have the army, who have some army part, they have their own army, they have the biggest political party, they now want to do to carry out elections by themselves, something that doesn't look nice. So the best thing to do here is just go down, fight them, and see that they're done. Even when they want them to surrender and all those things, they refused. So what do you expect when people don't agree and you all have guns?
And you're the president and you have to establish your authority.
People have to die. So there's worry because some people actually ran into Sudan, Eritrea, and neighboring countries for the refugee status now just went up.
But do you see these countries where refugees have gone getting involved? Because, I mean,
no.
Tigray are going into their regions and they shouldn't be asking President Abiy to get organized.
I don't see any of those countries getting involved in that matter because it gets worse. The only country that I think made, which is Eritrea, they just made peace sometime, not even one and a half years.
Yes, yes.
They just made peace. That's the only country that would react differently. But then it's not affected.
Mm-hmm.
Even refugees who run there know they cannot. They may be welcomed, but what is there for them? Eritrea is as poor as, I don't know, as them
many,
themselves running there.
Yeah.
So they usually run to Sudan, the main Sudan, Egypt, those countries just around there. So there's less hope, I would say, for them.
Yeah, but what does the rest of the nation in Ethiopia feel? About President Abiy actually going after the Tigray to try and establish authority.
It's a mixed
reaction. Does he have that kind of support?
He has the support in the government because he runs it.
Yes.
But in the mass, the mass population, it's a mixed reaction because there are people who are still leaning to that party.
Of course.
And they disagree with what Abiy did. That's why there's a huge debate of was it too soon to give him the Nobel Peace Prize. Yeah, so it's a debate, but he has to do what he has to do.
Mm-hmm.
Being a leader, that's a test.
You have
to go through. Go that direction or leave people die, or leave people, you know, just conduct their own elections? That means you will not have a government. You will have a government within a government.
Of course.
So he has to fight that kind of thing. But it's a tough one for him.
Wow. Thank you very much, Darren Bartlett, for that update on what's going on the international scene. Now, a quote today reads like this: the pessimist sees difficulty in every opportunity, the optimist sees opportunity in every difficulty. And I'll read that again: the pessimist sees difficulty in every opportunity, while the optimist sees opportunity in every difficulty. It's just about perspective. Don't you agree, Dad?
No, I agree. One of the businessmen I follow the most, Elon Musk, says, when you're starting a business, you start where problems are now.
Yeah.
That's where the difficulty is now.
Yeah, some people run away from the problem.
He first comes and sees the problem and knows, now the solution to this person is let me give them food.
Okay.
So he creates a business for supply of food and then you guys deal it.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the other group says when there is difficulty, there is no opportunity here.
Definitely.
Why am I going to deal with people who are in problems? Not knowing that the people who are in problems actually are the ones looking for solutions and which you can provide in exchange of, you know, money. So it's a mindset thing. It's really a mindset thing. Yeah.
Definitely. Thank you very much for joining us for this segment. We will be right back as Urban Today continues.
Urban Today, brought to you by
Metropolitan International University, we offer postgraduate diplomas, bachelor's degree, diploma, certificate programs, weekend, day and evening. Registrations in progress at our campuses.